thank you, Suzette. Can everybody hear me okay? Thank you to University of Alaska Fairbanks and the Peace Club here, and to the Alaska Peace Center, and Rob Mumford, and all the people in the Peace Center that I've been meeting with, and the local media, which has been terrific. All the radio stations and the Daily Miner that has published articles and op-eds and so forth. Raise your hand if you're here because of radio, of a radio show. Thank you. Raise your hand if you're here because of a newspaper. Raise your hand if you have secret powers of wisdom and didn't need them. Good to know. Good to know. Thank you all for coming through what to me is quite cold weather. I'm going to talk about some things that you are not supposed to know, which is different from things that are disputed or false. It's just things that you are not supposed to know. And I think this is a phenomenon that is more common than we sometimes realize. There are institutions of so-called higher learning in this country where if you write a research paper and you cite documents from WikiLeaks, they will say, no, actually, that's forbidden information. You can't use that information. Not that it's false, not that it's disputed, not that it's questionable, just not permitted. There's a building across the courtyard here called the Ernest Gruning Building, named for a former senator of Alaska, who was one of two United States senators out of the entire United States Senate, who said no to the Gulf of Tonkin resolution to create a massive war in Vietnam. And he and a guy from Oregon named Wayne Morse, who were the two senators who voted the right way, publicly said that lots of their colleagues in the cloakroom, as they put it, agreed with them, but on the floor of the United States Senate would not agree with them. It was not acceptable, it was not permissible, it was not patriotic for them to know that the Gulf of Tonkin incident was a fraud. They had to pretend to think otherwise. There was obvious, open, visible, known phenomenon in the past year of an institution called the Democratic National Committee rigging its own primary and going out of its way to defeat a guy named Bernie Sanders. And somebody unnecessarily confirmed that with additional information for us by leaking a bunch of emails from the Democratic National Committee. So we watched them conspiring with their friends in the media to boost one candidate and, you know, pull down another candidate. And whenever anyone in the Democratic Party or just about anyone else is asked about that in the US media, they say, well, that is illegal information. That was stolen information, stolen by the Russians. Right? Now, never mind that they haven't shown us the slightest bit of evidence about who stole it. What does it mean to be illegal information? This is like when a person walks across a border and then they're called an illegal person. What does that mean? What does it mean for information to be not worth knowing, not worth caring about because of where it supposedly came from? You know, if someone warned me that someone was raiding around the corner to murder me, and then somebody else said, hey, that's stolen information, and that guy's a Russian, would I just blissfully walk around the corner and not care? I would be dead. You know, where something came from is a different question, interesting question, but a different question from whether it's a useful thing to know. And I actually think it's useful to know when elections are rigged. You know, the Republican primary was rigged, not by the Republicans, but by media outlets that thought it would be fun and good for their ratings to show one candidate hundreds of times more than the other candidates. The CEO of CBS said, well, it may not be good for America, but it's damn good for CBS, about the decision to just saturate the airwaves with Mr. Trump. You know, that this was public, this was noble, but you're not supposed to know it. And you're not supposed to know that the Democratic National Committee's primary was similarly rigged, in this case, by the Democratic National Committee. I like to know not just how you got here, but who you are. So let me ask this. Three categories of people You think every U.S. war is good. You think some wars are necessary. Or you think no wars are necessary, all we ought to abolish war. Raise your hand if you think every U.S. war is good. Be brave, you can do it. Okay, raise your hand if you think no war is ever necessary and we ought to abolish the whole enterprise. Wow, you guys are wonderful. Raise your hand if you think some wars are necessary, sometimes and some aren't. Okay, so the second group, who agreed with me and are right, are way more numerous in this room than in most rooms in the United States. We are, an above-average group here, like the kids in Lake Wobegon. Okay, the last group, those of you who said some wars are necessary, put your hands back up. Keep your hand up if you can tell me how many nations President Barack Obama has ordered bombed. Keep your hand up if you can name the nations. So this is an interesting phenomenon, all right? Not since at least the Roman Empire has there been a group of people who couldn't keep track of their wars. This is unprecedented. And at the same time, many of us believe that we know which wars are good and which wars are bad, or in theory we could know that. And yet we can't even keep track of the wars. This is incredible to me. The answer I was looking for, by the way, is 8. And the 8 would be Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iraq, Syria, Libya, Somalia, Yemen, and in a much more minor way, the Philippines. And this is something that our president has bragged about. It's not some sort of secret. And it really is unique in the history of the world for there to be a nation that puts this amount of resources into militarism. U.S. military spending, by most calculations, is over half of discretionary spending, over half of the spending that Congress decides what to do with every year, and is roughly half world military spending, with much of that other half being NATO allies and supposed military friends of the United States. And much of the spending by the entire globe is on weaponry that's made in the United States. The United States is the number one supplier of weaponry to other countries. Democracies, dictatorships, the Middle East, Africa. So we think of these other certain regions of the globe as inherently violent, often with the wrong skin color and the wrong religion and the wrong language. But there's not a weapons factory anywhere in sight. The weapons are all coming from 80% of them are coming from 6 countries. The 5 members of the UN Security Council, an institution created supposedly to end war, plus Germany. And far and away the leader, the United States of America. So there's a problem with U.S. militarism in terms of facilitating wars around the globe. It's quite common for there to be U.S. weapons on both sides or multiple sides of wars these days. You have in Syria U.S. trained and armed forces trained by the Department of so-called Defense fighting U.S. trained and armed forces trained by the so-called Central Intelligence Agency. This is militarism gone mad, and it's unheard of in the rest of the world. You can watch the Super Bowl or the World Series, and they will thank the troops for watching in 175 countries. These are the ones they admit to having troops in. There are about 200 countries in the world. 175 is quite a lot of countries. All other countries on the globe combined have foreign bases that amount to about 12. The United States, 900 to 1,000, depending on how you count them, military bases in other people's countries, not counting thousands in the actual United States. This is unheard of. This has never been done before. And if 2 countries tried to do it, that would, it would be over. It couldn't be done. We also have an unprecedented level of acceptance of war. There was a Republican primary debate on television several months ago now, where one of the moderators asked, would you be willing to be commander-in-chief to kill hundreds and thousands of innocent children as part of your duty as commander-in-chief? Are you up to the task? This was a question by a moderator in a televised Republican, happened to be a Republican, could have been Democratic, primary debate. Didn't make the news as some kind of scandal. It was just the norm, and yet there's not another country on earth where that sort of question could be asked. In Syria, you get news stories now about U.S. troops having to consider various options to defend against Syrian aggression on U.S. troops in Syria, which the U.S. troops have invaded. Right? This is a way of talking as if you own the world that nobody else does. There was a big outcry months ago about candidate Hillary Clinton. Let us see the Goldman Sachs speeches. If you didn't say anything to those bankers that you wouldn't say to us, let us see the videos and read the transcripts. Well, now you can read three of the transcripts. And one of the interesting things, to my mind, that she said the CEO of Goldman Sachs, Lloyd Blankfein and company, was that she was proud of having told China that the United States could claim the right to the entire Pacific Ocean, and in fact had discovered Japan, for goodness sakes, and had bought Hawaii. This is a way of thinking about the world that other people don't do. You know, if you read Secretary Clinton's op-ed, I think it's in Time, it's either Time or Newsweek this week, she has a little op-ed about why the United States is so exceptional, and U.S. exceptionalism, and the indispensable nation, and better than all the other nations, and so forth. It reads as if she talks about the United States exactly as Donald Trump talks about Donald Trump. Right? I mean, it's a nationalized narcissism that is the norm. It's not her, it's the norm in Washington, D.C. to talk that way. The last election cycle 4 years ago, may have been eight, I can't keep track anymore, there was another Republican primary debate. It was in South Carolina, and Ron Paul, the Libertarian, was one of the candidates. And he said, I wanna end these wars. And a big chunk of the room just cheered, you know, and I want to scale back this militarism. And there was no booing or anything, cheers from at least a big chunk of the audience. And then he said, I want to apply the golden rule to other countries. I think the United States should treat other countries the way we'd like them to treat us. And he was booed for quoting Jesus Christ in a Republican primary debate because he had suggested that other countries were sort of as valuable as this country. Right? Yeah, you don't do that in U.S. politics. So this creates a sort of mindset in the United States where people start talking about war as if it's just normal, as if it's inevitable, as if it's part of human nature. And if the other 96% of humanity is not really engaging in war in remotely this sort of way, well, that's just a little quirk. That's not your basic human nature, which is this 4% of humanity over here, where we are. And there's no logical or historical or anthropological argument for it, right? For most of the existence of this species, there was nothing that resembled war. We were hunter-gatherers, you know? We were victims of large animals. We were prey. We were combating lions and bears. We were not engaged in warfare. And since the creation of big settled permanent cities by humanity, war has been a sporadic thing that's existed here and there. Most people, most of the time, have never been at war. You know, here I am talking about the United States as the most militarized state ever, and 99% of us have nothing to do with directly participating in war. And we don't suffer for that. There's no PTSD from war deprivation. It's unheard of, you know? And yet, to engage in war, it requires intense training and conditioning, the way you have to condition a fireman to not think and rush into a fire, because that's not what he or she is going to tend to want to do. You have to, in World War II, 80% of the troops didn't shoot at the enemy. You know, at Gettysburg, 80% of the troops didn't shoot at the enemy. They hadn't learned to condition people to thoughtlessly do that. But they still haven't figured out how to condition people to come back home and live with it. Because it's not natural. It's the opposite of natural. It's not normal. And it's absolutely evitable. Let me ask a sort of a different question. Do you think war is legal, sometimes legal, or never legal? Raise your hand if you think wars are always legal.
Revolutionary war.
You're on the sometimes, I didn't get there yet. Raise your hand if you think war is always legal. Sorry? Any existing laws? I mean, we can't all give an explanation, but on your interpretation. Okay, raise your hand if you think war is sometimes legal. And now if you think it's never legal. Okay, so again, the last group is very numerous and right. And right at least in this sense, that if laws are written things, right, if Article 6 of the Constitution of the United States that says any treaty the United States is a party to is the supreme law of this land, is law, even when everybody disregards it and violates it and nobody's punished for that. But if law is a written thing, rather than what people happen to get away with, which may have been what some of you in that second group were thinking. Well, the UN Charter makes all these current US wars illegal. The Kellogg-Briand Pact, which is almost forgotten, but is still written down, makes every single war illegal. I wrote the biggest news story in every big media outlet in the year 1928, bigger than Charles Lindbergh, was the creation of a pact that all the big nations became party to that banned war, called the Kellogg-Briand Pact, and it's still on the books. This is not secret history dug out of CIA escapades. It's just forgotten history written out of history. If that's how we do laws, if they're written things, then war is illegal. And so coming out of this tradition that goes back to, you know, ancient and medieval saints who, you know, Augustine up to Aquinas and people who favored monarchy and slavery and racism and sexism and killing Jews and heretics and so forth, and we've managed to set a lot of that stuff behind. Everything except war, which is, you know, just carried on way beyond its expiration date. These guys, you know, came up with a theory that you have to separate the ethics of starting a war with the ethics of how you conduct a war. Well, now, in the West, the big human rights groups just do the second part. Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, et cetera, as a matter of principle, just ignore the question of whether starting a war is legal. They're blatantly illegal, all of them. Under the UN Charter, there are narrow exceptions that none of these current wars meet. Under the Kellogg-Briand Pact, there are no exceptions. They just look at the conduct during a war. Well, were there how many atrocities, what sort of atrocities, et cetera. And this allows wars to be started and wars to be continued. And this sort of meaningless discussion that's all in the eye of the war maker of whether something is proportional and so forth during a war is all the conversation that we're permitted on our televisions. So I wrote this book called War is a Lie. I wrote it because there were very smart people telling me that 2003 in the United States was some sort of an exception. You know, that for the first time a president had lied about a war, and you know, this shouldn't stand. And I said, that can't be right. And I went back and looked through other wars. The Gulf of Tonkin incident I mentioned, we could discuss, it actually didn't happen. The blowing up of the Maine in Havana Harbor that launched the Spanish-American War, that in fact Spain wanted to go to arbitration and the United States wanted a war. All the lies of President Wilson on World War I and all the lies of President Roosevelt about World War II and so forth. And I went through every war and I couldn't find a war in US history, foreign history, any history of any country that didn't use very similar lies to get it started, to continue it, to make it look better after the fact. So I said, I'm not going to go through every single war, but I'm going to come up with the categories of types of lies so we can be better prepared. Because in 01, according to certain polls, and in 03, according to certain polls, you had a majority of this country say, we want a war. And within a year and a half, in both cases, and ever since, in every poll I've seen, you had a majority say, never should have started that war on Afghanistan, in Montes, and on Iraq. So obviously there's a chunk of the country that would benefit from catching on more quickly, right? And so I wanted to create a guidebook to let you spot the problems more quickly, right? And one way you do that is by understanding that not only are they almost certainly lying about the answers, but they're asking the wrong question, right? The United States is chock full of weapons of mass destruction. Nobody should bomb the United States. But we're presented with this question, does Iraq have weapons of mass destruction or not? And we're supposed to weigh on that whether to bomb Iraq. Well, it's the wrong question. The United States has a bunch of ships off the coast of Vietnam and has been sinking Vietnamese boats and bombing the coast of Vietnam. And supposedly, a North Vietnamese ship shot back. Well, the question isn't did they or not. The question is, how in the world is that aggression against the United States of America? Right? When a Russian plane flies near a US plane in the Baltic or the Black Sea, the first question shouldn't be exactly what maneuver did each pilot make. The first question should be, which coast of the United States is the Baltic Sea off of? Right? So it's always the wrong question. And if you can grasp that, then you can immediately spot the lies without waiting for Freedom of Information Act requests and so forth, you know. I mean, by the time that the great journalists like I.F. Stone questioned the Gulf of Tonkin incident, a couple weeks later, the resolution had been passed the next day, you know. The only people to question it were those two senators that I mentioned, one with the building next door. The other thing, I noticed in writing the new edition of this book was that with the change in power to a Democratic president from Bush to Obama, the war lies didn't cease, didn't change. And the lies about Libya, the lies about going back into Iraq and Syria, the lies about the drone wars and so forth, all follow the same pattern. And yet there's been some signs of people catching on and getting fed up and saying no. So in 2013, President Obama said he wanted to bomb Syria. And Secretary Kerry said, let's bomb Syria. And sometimes they talked about it as a little pinpricks, and sometimes they talked about it as a massive bombing campaign. What Seymour Hersh found, though, was that it was indeed going to be an extremely massive bombing campaign. And President Obama had decided on it and promised it to John McCain and the War Hawks on Capitol Hill. Raytheon's stock was higher than it's ever been before or since, $1.4 million for each missile that they were going to throw like confetti. And both political parties, every media outlet, everybody said this is going to happen. And largely because of public pressure, because of pressure over the previous decade around Iraq that had Congress members saying, I don't want to be the one who votes for another Iraq. Pressure that had built up in the United Kingdom where Parliament said no to a prime minister on war for the first time since Yorktown. Pressure inside the US military where the chairman and the Joint Chiefs of Staff clearly thought this was crazy. President Obama has admitted that it was largely public pressure that made him reverse his decision. And this is the last thing they ever want to admit. I mean, this is the biggest lie they most consistently tell, is that you have no power. You know, this is the demobilizing force that they use so effectively. No, he admits it in this case. Now, very partial victory. Did not switch to accepting peace proposals or disarming or working for a ceasefire or providing massive humanitarian aid as needed. You know, instead continued arming fighters on the ground in Syria, which the public was even more against than US bombing, exacerbated, prolonged the crisis, looked for a new propaganda opening the next year with the ISIS videos, but a victory nonetheless that showed that pressure can stop something. And last year, this Iran agreement that had one side saying, no, we need a war, and the other side saying, no, let's have an agreement. You had public pressure win on that one. And you know, this has been going on with Iran for years now. And the longer it goes on, the easier it is to say, when you desperately, urgently needed a war on Iran 12 years ago, and 8 years ago, and 3 years ago, why are we supposed to believe you need it now? You know, the more times we stop this, the easier it's going to be to keep stopping it. But then somebody has to start asking the question, if we can stop that one, why not everyone? Why not every single war? What is different about some war that we can't stop it? The rather frightening thing, probably the most frightening thing that Hillary Clinton said to Goldman Sachs was when Lloyd Weinfein asked, you know, we don't really need a big occupation of Iran. We've had these big occupations of Afghanistan and Iraq. We don't need one of Iran. And they use the word occupation, you know, because this is not a debate. This is, you know, a meeting of bankers, letting them know what wars will be fought for the bankers. Hillary Clinton said, no, just bombing, not an occupation. And Blankfein said, quite intelligently, bombing populations into submission has never actually worked, has it? Right, because this was always the theory back to World War II. You'll bomb the people into submission. They'll overthrow their ruler because you bomb them. Which the result is always the opposite. Right? This was what shock and awe was about. You shock and awe them into submitting and overthrowing their government and loving you and welcoming you with flowers and chocolate. It's never worked. And Hillary Clinton said, yeah, but Iranians are not democratic people. So this might be the time when it works. That doesn't frighten you, you know. We need to watch some ISIS videos or something. The other thing I feel like I have to tell people is that we need to come to grips with facts that are uncomfortable to know, including that all governments lie to their people. There's a great film coming out largely about the reporter I mentioned earlier, I.F. Stone, called All Governments Lie, that you should watch. But they do. All political parties lie. Either whichever team you're more inclined to cheer for in the U.S. government that's been divided into, you know, two parties rather than three branches now, lies. Lies a little differently from the other team, but lies. Another fact that's very difficult for people to come to terms with, even though rationally it makes sense, is that ISIS is way down the list of dangers. It's below staircases. It's below driving while sleeping. It's below toddlers with guns. It's below, you know.
Not if you're in Aleppo.
There. What is Aleppo? the fact is that toddlers who find guns in their houses kill many more Americans than do foreign terrorists. And we don't decide that toddlers are evil, and toddlers have the wrong religion, and toddlers are inherently bad, and so forth. We understand that somebody left a gun where they shouldn't have. It wasn't, you know, entirely the toddler's fault. Well, you know, ISIS is adults, you know, we can hold them responsible for their horrible and outrageous and atrocious crimes. But their weapons provided by the United States and Europe, the chaos that they grew out of was created by the overthrow of the government of Iraq, by the training grounds created in Abu Ghraib and the other prison camps in Iraq. When they ask in full-length movies for the United States to bomb them because they know what it will do for their recruitment, and the United States says, oh, okay. You know, there's a little blame to be spread around. And when we know that what the United States and allied governments are doing is counterproductive, that it's fueling this violence and continue it, and don't switch to other policies that might actually help, it doesn't excuse. You know, blame is not a limited quantity. You know, there's infinite amount to go around. It doesn't excuse any of the evil things that ISIS does, but it does put some blame on other parties. the first chapter of War is a Lie is called Wars Are Not Fought Against Evil. Because the propaganda for wars largely focuses on some evil force that supposedly cannot be talked to, cannot be reasoned with, you cannot go to the structural roots of the problem and help people and take opportunistic people away from supporting some evil force. You cannot work nonviolently for change. They only understand force. You know, like Iranians will be bombed into submission because they are Iranian. And usually the evil is, you know, caricatured into a single individual, right? So you're not going to bomb Panamanians, you're going to bomb Noriega because he wears red underwear and does drugs and he's evil, you know. I mean, this was the propaganda. Assad, Noriega, Putin, Bin Laden, there's always an evil face. Vladimir Putin on Time Magazine's cover is trying to interfere with U.S. elections. He's a force of evil. This is key to war propaganda. But what actually drives the hostility toward a country like Russia, that is, you know, the most dangerous at this point? There are, what, 16,000 nuclear weapons, and all but 1,000 of them are in the United States and Russia. What drives that hostility and the lack of any hostility toward Saudi Arabia or Bahrain or any of a dozen brutal dictatorships worse than the violations of Russia, which are significant, that the United States props up and arms and supports, or the lack of hostility toward Guantanamo Bay, or, you know, when North Dakota charges journalists with felonies for filming protests of pipelines. Nobody proposes bombing North Dakota, right? Why, is it really concern for human rights that creates the drive to bomb other countries in the name of human rights? And a woman in Mosul who's not allowed out of her house without a male guardian and is suffering under a horrible state of affairs, is she better off after her roof caves in on her and her family and a thud and a cloud of smoke? You know, isn't there a right not to be bombed that ranks fairly high in the human rights we ought to be concerned about? I think what drives the targeting of other nations is in part profits, and the profiteers are shamelessly open about this in a way that they haven't been in past decades, and they talk about it to newspapers now. The profits that come from NATO expansion and building up hostility with Russia, and part of it is ideology, including this sort of exceptionalism that I talked about before. You have the head of the National Endowment for Democracy talking about the need to overthrow Putin, because this is how you spread democracy. If you look at some of the recent wars from the perspective of War is a Lie, you look at one like Libya, we were told that the Western militaries needed to go and rescue innocent people from a pending massacre, when there was no evidence, the evidence was all to the contrary, that there was about to be a massacre. And as soon as they got that permission, that fig leaf of pseudo-legality from the United Nations, which is brought about by the existence of these loopholes in the UN Charter that aren't in the Calabrian Pact, they immediately and predictably, and without pause and without resistance or question, proceeded to overthrow the government of Libya. And the president was sodomized with a knife and murdered. And the Secretary of State went on television and giggled and laughed and said, "We came, we saw, he died." And the weapons proliferated across the region, and a US armed killer took over Mali, and more weapons than even were intentionally being sent before by the CIA went into Syria. And Libya is a disaster, and you had the UN, the US ambassador to the United Nations, Samantha Power, write a column saying, "Do not look at Libya You have a responsibility not to look at Libya, so you will be properly supportive of bombing Syria. You know? And often they say, look at Rwanda or Sudan, or look at some war that didn't happen, you know, because that's the one that would have been a good war. When obviously there was never a moment when bombing Rwanda was going to help anybody. You know, everything just should have been done differently in Rwanda. We could talk about how, but it never was bombing going to help anybody. But it's, you know, the wars that have actually happened, the humanitarian wars, there hasn't been one that benefited humanity yet. Yemen, you have a replay of the Gulf of Tonkin incident off of Yemen, and the pretense that the U.S. is going to get into a war that supposedly it hasn't been part of in Yemen, where the success, so-called successful U.S. drone war contributed to the crisis, and the U.S. has been arming and participating in the bombing of Yemen all this time. Saudi Arabia could not have been doing it without the United States. You have now Hillary Clinton telling Goldman Sachs that a no-fly zone on Syria would be way worse than Libya and kill lots of Syrians, and people shouldn't go around glibly talking about it. And in the debates, being the leading person going around glibly talking about it, and the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff saying this will mean war with Russia. You know, this is no joke. The recent wars that people tend to say are the good ones are typically Afghanistan, which was no more legal, was rejected by the UN just like Iraq, and was no more necessary. There was the ability to negotiate a trial of bin Laden rather than 15 years of a war on terrorism increasing terrorism. Is no more beneficial. The people of Afghanistan, just like the other seven nations in the list, worse off. Sometimes it's the war on ISIS, we must have a war on ISIS. But if you look at the alternatives of continuing to make it worse versus switching to actual aid and disarmament and diplomacy and the rule of law and leading by example, there's no contest. And sometimes it's the drone wars. And President Obama has created this mythology around the drone wars that we're only killing the people who can't be arrested, and the people who are imminent threats to the United States of America, and the people who we know exactly who they are, and we've got their biography, and you know we have to kill them, and so forth. There's not a single case where these criteria have been met. You know, we know of countless cases where the person could have been easily arrested. Most people killed by drones haven't been identified at all. Who they are whatsoever, and in not a single case has anyone been an imminent and continuing threat to the United States of America. And as a matter of fact, if anybody teaches logic at this university, something that is imminent isn't something that's continuing. And if it's continuing, it wasn't imminent. But somehow, this threat has to be imminent and continuing to just go on being imminent forever. So I was invited a couple weeks ago to speak at a university in Vermont, and there's this debate happening in the Catholic Church right now. I'm not Catholic or even religious, but I take an interest in it because it affects all of us, over whether a war can ever be just and whether the Pope should reject, after 1700 years of pushing the idea, the notion that you can have a just war. And so they invited me to speak on the idea that you can't have a just war at this Catholic university in Vermont. And I said, well, can you get somebody who thinks you can and we'll debate? It'll be a better event that way. And they invited somebody. I wrote down all my thoughts into what became a small book, the other book that I have up there called War is Never Just. And I sent it to him and said, here's no surprises. Here's what I'm going to say. What are you going to say? And let's have a written exchange we can publish too. Well, he immediately had pressing personal and business concerns and couldn't make it anymore. But they found a replacement guy, another professor who pushes just war theory, which, I spoke with a woman who was at this meeting at the Vatican in April with the cardinals about, throwing out just war theory. And she talked to people from seminaries in Africa and elsewhere, and they don't do just war theory. Never heard of it, It's the same Catholic Church. The Catholic Church picked up just war theory with Empire, with Constantine, and this is where just war theory lives, and it's all over U.S. academia, probably more than anywhere else. Well, they found another guy, so there you can watch a video on my website of me debating that guy, but the book I've written was debating the first guy. But the revolution, this is a just war to people, the revolution. And the reason Canada hasn't had to fight one yet, you know, has something to do with hockey. I don't know. Why is the rest of the British Empire not had to have one, you know? Or the Civil War. You know, and by the way, the nonviolent tactics, you know, predating Gandhi, I mean, the U.S. colonists who were creating alternative governments, who were creating homespun clothing, who were using nonviolence and tea parties, in fact, very effectively before the turn to violence. That was, you know, an upper crust sort of turn to violence. It wasn't a populist turn to violence. You know, the nonviolence was working quite well, thank you. The Civil War, you know, is a big one for people because you attach a just cause like ending slavery to a war, and you say, well, there you go, it's a just war. And why so many other countries ended slavery without a civil war is never explained. I mean, if we wanted to end fossil fuel consumption, would we first go find some fields and kill 750,000 of each other, and then come back and write a law to end fossil fuel consumption? Or would we just skip to writing the 13th Amendment and not do the war first? Why do you have to have the war first? And I'm reading a great book at the moment called The Slave's Cause, that's a history of the abolition movement. And you know, one thing it brings out is it's not just other countries, it was the northern half. I mean, the north had slavery too. They abolished it nonviolently over a period of years. It just hadn't gotten to the south yet. You know, it's not as if you can't end slavery without a war, and in fact it didn't. And the 13th Amendment left in slavery as punishment for a crime, and they immediately started punishing people with slavery across the South. And the bitterness and resentment and violence from the Civil War hasn't ended yet. You know, so the idea that it was, you know, that it was a smart way to end slavery just eludes me. But of course, overwhelmingly, I'm probably going on too long, and I want to get to questions. But the first question is always World War II, because overwhelmingly, you know, this is the just war, the necessary war, sometimes even the good war, as if a war can be good. And so just to at least start us on that topic, without World War I, no World War II. Without the stupid way of ending World War I, no World War II. And nobody ever says those are just, right? Without the Wall Street and Western funding of the Nazis leading up to, and in some cases right through World War II, and the provision of oil and weapons by American businesses right through World War II. No World War II. You know, without the arms race of the 1930s, no World War II. I mean, without all sorts of stupid decisions that were not necessary, no World War II. World War II was not a surprise. The U.S. government was not surprised in any way after having gone out of its way to provoke Japan, after having studied how to do it, come up with lists of how to do it, taken those actions. The president was 6 days off in his prediction of the Japanese attack, but that's not exactly being surprised. One of the justices at the Tokyo Tribunal concluded that the United States had provoked Japan, which in fact it did, as a means of fulfilling a commitment to Winston Churchill to get into the war in Europe. The lies about U.S. ships being innocently attacked by German subs when they were assisting British planes, taking a card from Winston, from Woodrow Wilson in the previous World War. The lies by President Roosevelt about having a Nazi map to slice up the Western Hemisphere and to eliminate all religions and so forth. I mean, these were just amateur forgeries. And you can claim those were necessary and just to get a reluctant people into a good war. Not honest though, not democratic. We have this myth built up. World War II is the number one topic of U.S. entertainment and culture and history. I am absolutely convinced. You go to the airports I've been in the past couple of days, the bookstores all have World War II books all over the place. You go to Netflix or Amazon Prime, World War II, dramas and fictions and documentaries all over. The myth has been built up that because of how people are sold wars now, and it's to our credit that we have to be sold wars this way, but the myth has been built up that it was somehow humanitarian, or it was because of the evil of the death camps of the Nazis that somehow fighting that evil was necessary or good. But in fact, the United States and the Western nations held meetings and decided not to let any Jews out of Germany. The peace groups went to the US government and to the British government, to Winston Churchill and to his foreign secretary, Anthony Eden, and said, get ships and planes and take the Jews out of Germany. And they said, be too much trouble, can't be bothered, not gonna do it. We watch these Anne Frank movies and we feel very indignant and superior. The State Department turned down her visa request, her father's visa request. There was a ship of Jewish refugees chased away from Miami by the US Coast Guard. You know, this was the position of the US government and of the majority of the US public and of the US president, to all of their everlasting shame. And so the idea that it had something to do with helping the victims of those camps, it was created after the war. And of course, during the war, possibly 10 times the number of people who died in the camps died in the war, right? So if you think of the war as a cure for the disease of the camps, something's askew there. This war was the worst thing humanity has ever done to itself. It was also not defensive. Germany was not attacking the United States. You can argue defending other countries that were defending other countries, but you can't argue defending the United States. It was not going to happen. This was after Germany was just finished taking over the Soviet Union, which was not going to happen. This was principally a war between Germany and the Soviet Union, by the way. The United States was a bit player, contrary to Hollywood. 27 million Russians killed, defeating the Germans. And this was a war that gave us all-out destruction, all-out war on civilians, leading up to the absolutely unjustified nuking of two cities. And an unending legacy of that imperialism and destruction to this day. This also was a war where the mythology has painted one side as good in modern terms as compared to the other side. But this was a side that was an apartheid state for African Americans, that put Japanese Americans in camps, that gave African American soldiers syphilis during the war to experiment on them, that gave people in Guatemala syphilis during the Nuremberg trials to experiment on them, that hired hundreds of top Nazis right after the war into the US military and they fit right in. Right? None of this excuses the evil of the Germans or the Japanese or anybody else. Again, blame is not a limited quantity, but the image of good and evil can be exaggerated. On top of which, going back 75 years, to find a justification for our leading expense, our biggest public project of each of those subsequent 75 years, is something that we don't do with anything else. It's kind of bizarre. And we know the power of nonviolent action now in ways that nobody knew back then. And when you look back then at the power of amateur, uninformed, spontaneous nonviolent action in Rosenstrasse in Berlin and elsewhere, and you think of the potential that people had been organized and really used it, it changes your perspective. So I'm going to skip some of this because I want to get to questions and answers and get as many as possible. But the question with this just war theory usually comes down to, so what do you do if you're attacked? What if the United States is really invaded by the next Hitler? You know, even if the original Hitler wasn't about to do it. And, you know, part of the answer is not the central answer, but part of the answer is that you can certainly minimize further the outlandishness of that fear by leading by example, by joining all the treaties and the International Criminal Court and abiding by the rule of law and disarming the globe. You create a reverse arms race immediately if the US government let it. And central to the answer is the power of nonviolence. I mean, nonviolent resistance to tyranny, and 90% of the examples are domestic tyranny, but there's also a growing list of resistance to foreign invasion, is more successful than violence. It's the stronger tool, and those successes are longer lasting, right? So if Canada invades Alaska, but the people of Alaska don't obey any orders, as the people of Norway and Denmark didn't obey any orders, nobody cooperates, and nobody turns on the electricity, and nobody runs the trains. Everybody blocks the roads, and everybody operates as if the Canadians don't exist. The Canadians don't exist. And if the rest of the world supports that nonviolent resistance, I'm sorry to use Canada in this example, when the United States has a history of invading Canada over and over, and then the reverse has never happened, and Canada has sheltered our conscientious objectors and our people fleeing slavery and so forth. But, Russia or Canada invades Alaska, if there's no cooperation with an occupation, there's no occupation. The other question is, well, how do you help other people who are invaded? How do you go help the Kuwaitis or the Iraqis or the Syrians who are in need of humanitarian assistance? Well, one answer, I'm gonna pass something around if you'll help me, but one answer is the poll that Gallup did 2 years ago of 65 countries and asked, what country is the greatest threat to peace on earth? And the overwhelming winner was the United States. The world doesn't appreciate the global policing. It isn't helpful. But if you want to help people, do things that actually help them. There was a U.S. Air Force expert quoted in the Smithsonian magazine a couple months back saying, the U.N. is trying to drop food on starving people in Syria who are literally starving to death and not dropping it close enough, and they never find the food, and they die. And the U.S. Air Force has technology to drop accurately from high altitude in high winds. It costs about $60,000 a pop to use it. But we would never use it. As a matter of principle, we would never use it for a merely humanitarian operation. If it could be part of an operation to kill a lot of people, well then, as a matter of principle, we'd be willing to use it. Again, each missile, $1.4 million. Right? So if you shifted priorities to literally helping people eat, if that mattered, and not using it as an excuse to create a no-fly zone, but using it as an excuse to ship them food, well, then you have a different outcome. I'm part of this organization that we started up called worldbeyondwar.org that has this very short statement that says we want to end all war in the world, which I hope maybe a few of you who said some wars are good will feel inclined to sign at this point. But if not, we'll keep working on it. But those of you who said no wars are good, if you'll please add your name. People in 136 countries have signed this. We're not to the Pentagon's 175, but we're getting close. And this is an organization that tries to take out the message, first of all, of war's immorality, that it is the top killer, wounder, creator of suffering, rivals any disease in mortality and morbidity, and is completely avoidable and unnecessary. Is the leading creator of refugees. We wonder where all these refugees come from. They come from the wars. Millions of people killed in U.S. wars since World War II in largely one-sided slaughters. There's nothing more immoral. But also that none of that is the real killer. No weapon is killing remotely as many people as the use of money. Because when the world puts $2 trillion a year into war, and the United States puts $1 trillion a year into war, and $30 billion a year could end starvation on Earth, and $11 billion a year could end the lack of clean drinking water on Earth, and tens and hundreds of billions a year could transform sustainable energy and sustainable agriculture and education. And you go to countries that don't have the kind of money the United States has, and they've never heard of college debt. And college is free, and preschool is free, and healthcare is free, and retirement is guaranteed, and vacation, and better health, and better happiness, and longer lifespans. These are some of the trade-offs, right? And this is the number one way in which war kills. Like, don't beam these resources into it. This wonderful airplane, the best thing you can say about it is it doesn't fly, the F-35, that they're gonna bring to Alaska, and they're brought to Vermont, and they wanna bring to Japan. This thing, over 50 years, they're saying $1.4 trillion with a T for this one weapon, right? That, you know, can't fly, has no defensive purpose. If you were gonna scale back to a militarized defense, you think you need military for defense, but you got rid of the offensive-only weapons, the weapons for carrying nukes, the weapons for sneaking into other countries undetected, stealth airplanes. That's what this is. It's four times louder than the F-16. Any children anywhere nearby, their brains are damaged. People can't live near it. And when it crashes, as it often does, it puts all kinds of toxins into the air that you can't safely breathe. This disaster of an airplane, you know, is apparently something we want to invest money in, or our government doesn't. And we look around and we say, well, at least it's jobs. And you have Congress members defend war because it's jobs. I watched this panel discussion on a big stage, and one of the speakers is Vladimir Putin, and one of them is a former ambassador to the Soviet Union from the United States. And Putin says, why did you expand NATO to our border? The whole buffer zone is gone. Why the missile bases and the exercises right on our border? And this guy says to him, you got it all wrong, Vladimir. It's not a threat to Russia. It's just a way to create jobs back in the States. And he said, well, can't you create other kind of jobs? And in fact, if you look at the studies, there is no dispute that just in economic terms, even tax cuts for working people, not tax cuts as we've come to know and hate them, but tax cuts for working people, creates more jobs. Military spending is actually a drain. It's that we see all these military jobs everywhere. It's a mirage. But if you put the money into clean energy, or even more into healthcare, or even more by far into education, you get many more jobs and better paying jobs and better economic impact. So it's not actually, there's no economic argument for the military. The military is also our number one destroyer of the natural environment. It's not just the F-35, it's not just the Navy dumping lead and mercury into the water off the coast of Alaska. It's the Superfund sites all over the United States. It's the top consumer of petroleum. It's the third leading polluter of US waterways. It is far and away the biggest destroyer of the environment, largely in fighting wars for fossil fuels with which to fuel the wars, with which to fight for more fossil fuels, with which to destroy the environment. So, you know, we have an environmental movement and a peace movement, which is crazy. It's one movement. It should be one movement. It's the number one excuse to strip away our civil liberties. And first it's done to others who don't look like us, then it's done to us, and to militarize our local police. And no matter how much the wars are for freedom, we always have fewer freedoms at the end of them. And it is the most toxic influence on our culture in pushing violence and vengeance and racism and bigotry into our culture. You know, it's not something we're gonna end by next week, but if we can change it in stages, if we can do away with nuclear weapons, and the non-nuclear states are moving forward right now at the UN on a treaty to ban nuclear weapons, if we can do away with the foreign bases, if we can get back to defensive-ish weapons, you know, by stages, we can get to a world without militarism. And if we don't, we're gonna get to a world without humanity. So, you know, that's what worldbeyondwar.org is working on. And unlike most people, we're not focused on this obsession of the moment called an election. Because elections are not how you change the world. You know, Emma Goldman said if elections ever made a difference, they would ban them. I want them. I'd like to have a fair and effective and verifiable election in the United States someday. At the moment, we don't. You know, we need massive reforms. We need to get the money out. We need fair coverage. We need fair ballot access. We need to undo the gerrymandering. We need verifiable vote counts. We need, endless reforms. Some states are moving ahead on ranked choice voting and other reforms. Registration to vote. My God, almost every state has automatic registration for the military draft. And they're trying to impose it on young women now, too, in Congress. It's the crazy Republicans who view of women's rights comes out of the Bible that don't want to do it. All the good liberal Democrats want to impose it on women now, too. That's automatic everywhere. But I think we're now at 5 or 6 states that have made voting registration automatic. In the others, you have thousands of people running around registering people to vote and thinking they're doing activism, Bless their hearts, and then come the day after the election, they're burnt out. Rest up. Now is the time to rest up. After the election, they are going to try to ram through the Trans-Pacific Partnership. After the election, they are going to try to ram through a war supplemental spending bill so there's more money lying around in January for the next president. This is what they do after elections when nobody's paying any more attention and everybody's going to forget it 2 or 4 years hence, right? So the way, women didn't vote themselves the right to vote. Changes haven't come except through massive popular movements of education, mobilization, organizing, momentum building, and nonviolent action. And by all means, vote and vote for who you want to vote for, but don't think that that's the most important thing to do, and don't let up the day after. And I don't think you will. You're not a typical crowd, but go spread the word. And thank you very, very much for coming out here tonight. It's great to see you. Please use it just because we're making a video, and many more people are going to see this on video than are in this room. And
okay. Yeah, I was just wondering, did you say that we had 175 military bases or facilities?
I did not. I said the United States, not we. We are better.
Okay,
than
the United States.
Government has, depending on how you count them, 800 to over 1,000 military bases in 175 nations. And there being about 200 nations on the globe, 175, these are the ones they admit to. It's really more than 175.
Right.
It is quite a lot of nations.
Okay, so then I did understand you correctly, at least maybe I didn't say it the way you would have said it. But so I was just looking in Wikipedia because I was trying to figure this stuff out. I'm one of those people who thinks not only do Democrats and Republicans lie, I think pretty much most people do, including myself. And so, Wikipedia's got 29 countries. I can read them to you if you want me to, but I don't think you really do. I think I just dropped my phone.
I would love it if you'd email it to me later, and I'll give you my address, and you can find me at davidswanson.org. But if you read a book that David Fine, a professor at American University, put out last year on U.S. bases, he gives you the list of all the countries that have U.S. bases, and documents their names and where they are.
Yeah, that's what I like.
Are at them and so forth. And it is, of course, much more than 29. And in fact, if you email me, I'll point you to
absolutely
the resources. But if you go to worldbeyondwar.org, you'll find it. There's a section of maps on worldbeyondwar.org that maps everything militarism related. Who sells the weapons? Who buys the weapons? Where are the bases, etc. But if you also just do a search for David Vine, V-I-N-E. Mm-hmm. Who's just a great young professor at American University, or read his book, even better, you'll get the best info I know of.
Well, anybody who puts information out that we can link to and read about, instead of just having to take people's word for it, is a hero in my eyes, so thank you very much for coming and speaking,
yeah,
and for your service.
Well, I take that very well and agree and applaud you. You should not take anything for granted. You should question everything.
I was listening to a local station which just started recently in Fairbanks, and it's non-commercial. And it's the first time I ever heard this statement that both General Eisenhower and naval admiral, I can't remember his name, Leahy, stated before they dropped the bomb in Japan that the Japanese were defeated and it wasn't necessary. And then I brought this up to a friend of mine who was a World War II veteran, and he was a young 18-year-old boy that was ready to invade. And he said, no, they needed to drop the bomb. So what's your opinion of that?
Yeah, worldbeyondwar.org just had a conference in Washington at American University, and you can watch all the videos or the highlight video if you go to worldbeyondwar.org. And one of the speakers there was Gar Alperovitz, who really, really broke the story publicly in terms of reshaping historians' consensus decades ago on this, and just overwhelmingly convinced most historians that it was not, that there was no need to drop the bomb in order to end the war. And also speaking at the same conference was Peter Kuznick, who has been really the leader on this topic in recent years, who may be the person you heard something about recently. And he's got books and videos, and in fact it was several. It was all of the top U.S. generals. It wasn't just Leahy, who was the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, and it wasn't just Eisenhower, it was, you know, MacArthur, and all the rest of them said beforehand, don't do it, not necessary, said afterhand, unjustified. You know, Truman knew that Japan was ready to surrender. All they wanted was to keep their emperor. After the bombs had been demonstrated to the world and the Soviet Union, and the Cold War had been begun, and a couple hundred thousand people had been pointlessly murdered, and Truman had gone on the radio and lied that Hiroshima was a military base, and people had willfully bought into the lies, they let him keep the emperor, after all. You know, so this is, you know, a central myth to World War II for Americans. But it's not really taken seriously by most historians, even in this country anymore. I mean, the facts are just overwhelmingly the other way. And even Howard Zinn, who was a believer in U.S. militarism and a U.S. soldier at the time, and had been, you know, bombing Europe, and who just, you know, was thrilled at the news of nuking Japan because he thought, now I won't have to go over there. Came to himself write well-informed and powerful books in decades later about how it was absolutely unjustified. And of course, it was not somehow extravagantly different from the rest of World War II. I mean, those two cities were among the few that hadn't been burned to the ground already, right? You know, they had to pick cities that were still largely intact in order to demonstrate the power of the bombs. And they couldn't demonstrate it offshore to the same effect. They couldn't make the threat to the same effect. And one wasn't good enough because the second one was a different type of bomb that they wanted to also demonstrate. And they didn't bomb Kyoto because Henry Stimson had honeymooned there and thought it was lovely, right? But he'd never been to Hiroshima. Right? I mean, this is the morality of war making. I don't have my prepared.
Well, I think these are neat things to hear that you're saying, but I'm wondering, what can we as one individual in the middle of Alaska do to make any difference? I mean, if we believe what you say and want to end the war as a solution, what do we do as individuals right here?
Yeah, well, you join the Alaska Peace Center, you sign the clipboard I passed around, you do events with all the resources that are on the website at worldbeyondwar.org and get more people in the room and educate more people. You do book events with the books, you do film events with the films. You go to the schools and counter the recruitment efforts with counter recruitment information. You work on the school boards to get the military tests out of the schools. You join with the people who I'm told have been successful thus far in keeping a drone base out of Alaska that they've been trying to put in. You join the movement opposing the F-35 worldwide. I was just in Vermont where they've got the F-35 in Burlington. Now I'm here where it's coming. They're trying to put it in Japan and elsewhere. We're going to start a petition online and get 100,000 signatures or more with these organizations in these different locations. And potentially many more. We're going to maybe target not just the Congress, but some 8 or 9 other countries that now are going to buy this airplane. Not as a step to getting a better airplane or basing it in a better place, but as a step toward ending war. Join in the efforts to force questions into media covered election campaigns that aren't in there. Go and disrupt events and ask the questions that aren't being asked. Go and demonstrate. And sit in and don't leave in your representatives' offices to get information out there. I wrote an op-ed to the Daily Miner and they put it right in there and didn't mess with it much. Write those all the time. Write letters. Make phone calls. Get on the radio stations, which in this town seem very open to the subject. Celebrate. People like Bruning, who has this building over here, make a video of yourself interviewing students walking by and asking if anyone knows who he was. Ask them if they know who the guy was who replaced him, Mike Gravel. Ask if they know what Mike Gravel, read into the record without a bathroom break, which was, of course, the Pentagon Papers. Educate people about successful peace efforts that inspire them. A lot of people, for some reason that eludes me, have to know that it succeeds before doing it. Explain to them how we stopped a war in 2013, but we need to stop it again. How we keep stopping a war on Iran, and they're going to have to keep stopping it again. The presidential election is apparently largely decided. So drop that activity and start going after all of the candidates on their war positions. Katha Follett in The Nation magazine says Hillary Clinton is going to reduce military spending. Hillary Clinton never said that. Her website says get rid of the sequester limitations so we can raise the spending. Donald Trump's fans say he's going to cut military spending. Not Donald Trump. He says we're going to rebuild the military that's practically gone and decrepit. Educate people through independent media, through getting into the corporate media. Go after the corporations that are making the weapons. We're working on a divestment campaign. There's some campaigns doing very well. Divest from Israel. Divest from nukes. Divest from fossil fuels. We're working on a campaign to at least start with divesting public funds from the top weapons makers. It makes no sense for New York teachers' retirement to depend on bigger weapons sales. Teachers should be advocates for education, not for more wars, right? So, there's endless avenues and there's endless examples of successes. The Congressional Research Service a few years ago just stopped reporting on weapons sales. Foreign weapon sales, so you couldn't say the U.S. is the leading seller of weapons to the rest of the world anymore because you didn't have those numbers. We lobbied them and with an online petition that, as far as we know, helped, but in any case, they restarted reporting that. Some of the worst war entertainment shows on television, we've lobbied to get off. So take advantage of the big military celebrations and holidays and go with a different message and speak and flyer and poster and lobby. I know that back when the Democratic Party was supposedly anti-war and there was a big new war on Iraq, there were people out at an intersection in this town all the time protesting for 3 or 4 years. start that back up, because the wars didn't stop, the protests just stopped, you know? So there's lots of it.
Hi, thank you for your talk. This just popped in my Facebook feed. I checked Facebook. Everything I read by David Swanson, including a piece run by the local newspaper, looks like if he was on Putin's payroll. He defends Crimea annexation, openly says that Ukrainian revolution was sponsored by the U.S., and accuse the U.S. of every evil in the universe, this part I heard. One has an impression that one reads Russian propaganda piece. Yes. So if this popped into your Facebook feed, how would you comment?
I would first of all, ask if the person who wrote that is here by any chance. Because this is the person I wanted to come to this event. I know some people that raised.
I will write the comments.
Yeah, well, send him the first paragraph of the column that I wrote in the Daily Miner, in which every word gave the impression that I was paid by Vladimir Putin. The first paragraph in which I said, if I lived in Russia, I would be protesting the abuses and offenses of Vladimir Putin, just as I push for major reforms in the country I do live in, the United States. In the same first paragraph, I often go on Russian media and criticize Russia. In the same first paragraph, Russia is immorally and illegally bombing people in Syria. Right? This is a problem that, just on a tangent for 1 second on Syria, is that you've got people in favor of U.S. bombing but not Russian bombing. Russian bombing but not U.S. bombing. Syrian bombing but not U.S. or Russian bombing. U.S. and Russian bombing if it's mostly of ISIS but not Syrian bombing. You've got 18 varieties, and the least common among them is everybody stop bombing people, right? But that's my position. Russia is illegally and immorally and destructively bombing people in Syria. And you say, oh, well, but they're doing it at the invitation of a sovereign government, and they're doing it for a better reason, and they didn't start it, and so, you know, I don't care. It's mass murder, you know. I actually have on my website an account from a couple years ago when I was given an offer, actually, to be sort of in the pay of Vladimir Putin, because a guy came up to me at a peace event in D.C., and I'm with the Russian Air Force, I'd like to talk to you, and then he met with me and sort of said, I want to feed you articles, and I want you to publish them under your name. And I said, you can tell me stuff, and I'll report that you told it to me. If you like how I report stuff, you want to like that, but I'm not going to lie for you. And, you know, and to cover myself, I just blogged about the whole conversation with his name and who he was and phone number and so forth. And, you know, so this is my reaction to an actual offer to collaborate with Vladimir Putin. Now, I have friends who have radio shows on Sputnik Russian media who are, I guess, in the pay of Vladimir Putin, but to my knowledge, they say what I would say, which is exactly what they think, you know? And for me to have suggested that the Crimean Revolution was organized by the United States is, first of all, to pretend that there's been a Crimean Revolution, and second of all, to put words in my mouth. What the United States facilitated, and it was exposed, including audio of phone calls, in the capital, in the west of Ukraine, was a violent coup that put in place an anti-Russian government, including Nazis, not metaphorical Nazis, Nazis, right? And the people of Crimea voted overwhelmingly to rejoin Russia after centuries of having been.
You're serious.
You believe what you just said?
I do believe what I just said, and I opposed Russia sending more troops into Crimea the day they did it. And I have posted on Russian media. But this coup, this seizure of Crimea, you know, had casualties of zero. The humanitarian invasion of Iraq killed over 1 million people. And so to lump them together, you know, it is a little bit of a distortion, right? Again, the Russian government is not a good government. It's not a respecter of human rights. It's not a model of civil liberties. It's not where I want to live. But to suggest that when the United States throws out its promises and expands NATO to the border and puts missile bases in Romania and Poland and lies about Russian crimes and aggression and alleges Russian invasions of countries where the United States has facilitated a coup, this is not aggression by Russia. We ought to be more afraid of the demonization of someone like Putin, his real faults notwithstanding, than we ought to be afraid of Putin. There are Vladimir Putin Halloween masks in U.S. stores. That seems funny. That ought to be extremely frightening, because this is how you get a war going. And whether you like, love, or hate the Russian government, if you want a war between the Russian and U.S. governments, you're crazy.
We want a war, right? Not the Russian government.
There are those in the U.S. government who want the war, or at least want to pressure an overthrow of it. I have no idea what you want. I'm sorry. I said, if you want a war between the Russian government and the U.S. government, you're crazy. If you don't, you're not crazy. Please.
I'm Christian and come from Russia and don't like war. So being in United States and being a United States citizen, but coming from the country, we've been, you know, and been scared by United States. You know, as United States, you know, state was so scary for us growing up, being living here. I looking at history, I don't know the facts that much. I don't really go in history to know really the dates and all these numbers. I looking what I live my life with, seeing United States as a big country in Russia. They playing the wars, but never in their own land. Crimea, like the whatever was the, like you just been saying, this is not the true by United States, it is. That's the only spot United States will have by the water. That land, if they will take over that land and help the country who is, you know, that Ukrainian side, United States will have side to come to Russia. Russia not that stupid. They playing this war for a long time. So they always gonna play the war. How we gonna stop this? Because as a citizen of United States, as a normal you and me, do you wanna be in a war? Did you want to, you know, your child to be shot? Did you want to hear, did you even been in the bombing when actually, you know, the building collapsed next to you? You don't want a war, but the big government, the big countries always been in a war.
Thank you.
I would like to say I was a World War II child. We we came to the United States in 51. Well, I'm also I'm over a territorial pioneer. I came to Alaska in 1956. And I spent enough time in the United States. And the thing is, I decided to come to Alaska. And in 1959, I took my pencil and I thought, no for statehood. Because what I seen then is what I see today. And my problem is, why can't the United States mind their own damn business? They got their face into everything. And if they think this is the best thing around is the United States, they got another guest coming. Because I have been around and I have studied and seen different places and what they have to offer. I think